I've never told you that before, so that is a lie.
So I get 2 points for that because I had them both right?
My confidence has just dropped into my ankles.
Because I wanted to see if I remembered what was the right answer.
It's too creative a lie for you to come up with.
You'd be wrong, John.
Correct, but no points.
That's why I shaved, John. Oh, no.
How do you want to resolve this, Kurt?
Hum, baby, hum, baby, hum. Fire that fastball in, because it's a new episode of Smart Drivel. Coming to you like the crack of a ball off a bat, right into your oiled mitt, which is your mind, which is your soul, which is you breathing in Smart Drivel. I'm your co-host, Kurt Schneider.
And I'm your co-host, John Ellenthal. Did you say hum, baby, Kurt?
Hum, baby, hum.
That made me think of, was it the Frank Zappa song, Dynamo Hum?
How does it go, John?
Where's the dynamo coming from? From the dynamo hum? All right, so you're not a big Zappa guy. All right. So, Kurt, we are going to use a classic format today, but we're going to put our own special Smart Drivel spin on it. We're going to play our own game, Kurt, of two truths and a lie.
Am I going to end up in 7 minutes in heaven with you in the closet?
I don't think we're going to have those kinds of consequences.
Okay, phew.
But we are going to have consequences. Every time I successfully fool you when you choose wrong, I get a point. Whenever you confuse me and I'm wrong, you get a point. Whenever we guess correctly, we each get a point. Do you accept my challenge?
So it's a competition?
Let's see who gets the most number of points.
Anyone who knows me knows that I'm the least competitive human being alive. I don't rise to the occasion of being competitive.
That was perfect, because that's a lie and that's part of the game. Two truths and a lie. Now, if you had said, here are three characteristics of Kurt, and one of them is I'm not very competitive, I would have known that was the lie. So beautifully done, Kurt.
I like gin martinis. I like peanut butter and jelly. I'm not competitive.
Okay. I'm going to go with I'm not competitive as the lie. Kurt, would you like to go first as the asker or as the answerer?
As the asker.
I am ready.
John Fitzgerald Kennedy. There are two truths and a lie about this president. One, he was the only president to earn a Purple Heart. Two, he was the youngest president ever. Three, he played football in college.
I am going to guess the lie is the Purple Heart.
You would be wrong, John.
Okay, so you get a point.
He did win a Purple Heart in World War II in the Navy. He did play football in college. While he was the youngest elected president, he was not the youngest president ever. That goes to Teddy Roosevelt, because when McKinley was shot in Buffalo, Teddy became president at 42 years of age, and Kennedy got elected at 43 years of age.
So is that how this is going to go? You're going to come up with these minor technicalities because he wasn't the youngest elected?
That's not a minor technicality.
I'm telling you that I was thinking about elected, but I hear you. So I'm wrong, but I understand that this is how you're going to play the game. So no problem. No problem. I got a little bit of a history lesson there, and you got a point, Kurt. Now let's turn the proverbial tables. You are now answering the question, which is going to require that you first listen to the question.
Okay.
This category relates to sports, sort of sports measurements, I'm going to call it. Number one, a golf course has 18 holes because there are 18 shots in a bottle of scotch. Mm-hmm. And Scotland is where golf was invented. So 18 shots, empty bottle, game over. Number two, the distance between two bases on a baseball field is 88 feet. Number three, a marathon is 26.2 miles because the distance is inspired by the legend of a messenger running from Marathon to Athens in Greece with news of a victory over the invading Persians. Two truths and a lie, Kurt.
All right. Well, here's the thing. I know that a marathon was named after the guy running from Marathon. It was 26 miles, not exactly 26.2, but I don't think you'd be that technical. So I'll say that's a truth, because it's true.
It's actually closer to 25 miles, to tell you the truth.
Yeah. So that's a truth, even though, because it's not 26.2, but that's fine. That's close enough. bases in between is 90 feet. You might say, yes, you think it's 90 feet, but it's 88, but I think it's 90 feet. 18 shots of scotch. Absolutely. I think that's what that is. I'm going to go with baseball because I think it's 90 feet in between bases. That's your lie.
Let me just take my pen out so I can update the scoreboard and add one in my column.
Why?
The lie was the golf course having 18 holes, which was to equal the number of shots in a bottle of scotch. Not only are there 25 shots in a bottle of scotch, but there are 18 holes on a golf course for a different reason. The old course at St. Andrews, which is actually many hundreds of years old, had 18 holes, and everyone else just sort of copied their format thereafter. Interestingly enough, it's only had 18 holes since 1764. Before that, it had 22 holes, but they shortened some stuff up. But is basically St. Andrews and its 18 holes since 1764 has been the blueprint for the number of holes on modern golf courses. You are correct that everyone thinks that there is indeed 90 feet between the bases, but because first base and third base are in fair territory, if you look at the actual distance between the bases, it's only 88 feet, so that is true.
It kind of was a trick. So that was a lie? No, so I was right then.
No, the lie was...
Oh, right. Scotch. Yeah.
You guessed the bases, and that was a truth.
Got it.
All right, your turn. We are both so far been wrong.
Okay. Then I bet you will get this correctly. All right. These are old wives' tales, John. Number one, cold weather can lead to a cold. Number two, eating carrots improves your eyesight. Number three, chicken soup can relieve a cold.
All right. So I actually think being in the cold can lead to a cold. I think I've heard something about some medicinal or therapeutic benefits of chicken soup. And I do not think carrots in the final analysis improve your eyesight. So I'm going to say the lie is carrots.
Oh, John. Carrots can indeed help with eye health.
Okay, but what
but
was...
not giving you better eyesight. You are correct. That is the lie.
Okay, excellent. So... why is it that everyone runs around saying to their kids, eat your carrots, it'll improve your eyesight, when in fact it doesn't improve your eyesight?
Well, it helps with eye health.
Oh, so it's just easier to say eyesight because that's more specific?
Because people get that, then do I care about my eye health? No.
Speaking of lies, and this is not something that either you nor I embrace, but Seth Godin wrote a book many years ago, which I think was tongue-in-cheek, titled All Marketers Are Liars. And in the carrot case, it's a way of saying something a little different so that it can ultimately catch on, that is based on a true story, but is not entirely true.
And you are correct that being in the cold can lead to a cold.
It makes sense, I guess, because
your immune system's down, right? That's what starts it. And then usually cold, you're next to people because then they're spreading stuff sooner. Anyway, all right, I'm ready, John. You took the lead, so I got to catch up here.
I'm going to go into a little bit of U.S. related history, or also known as U.S. history. You'll see why I said related at the end.
Yep.
Okay, two truths and a lie, Kurt. The first statement is the word God appears in the Declaration of Independence, but not the Constitution. Statement number two, the Star-Spangled Banner was written in 1814 and became the U.S. national anthem after the U.S. defeated the British in the War of 1812. Number three, Columbus had the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria, but personally sailed on the Santa Maria, which was the largest of the three ships. That's why I said related history, since he really didn't land in the U.S. Didn't discover America exactly, but so marketers.
A point of clarification. Did you say, because Francis Scott Key did write the Star-Spangled Banner in Baltimore, looking at the fight and Battle of 1812, but did you say it became the national anthem immediately following?
At the successful conclusion of the war, successful from the point of view of the Americans. So in the aftermath of the war, it became the national anthem, is the statement. Good clarification.
So that soon. Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, I know that number one is a truth because you've already told us that in the past.
I have never told you that before. So that is a lie.
You absolutely have. 100%. You, in one of our early podcasts, you talked all about it and you've actually seen the declaration and you couldn't believe.
I was making the point back then that the official name of the country was United.
Oh, right.
Based on which words were capital.
All right. Well, I'm saying that you're right. I'm saying that's a truth anyway.
Okay.
You know, it just sounds silly. He probably didn't go on the biggest boat. So I think Columbus sailing onto Santa Maria is the lie.
So you think he would have gone on one of the smaller boats?
Well, wait a second. But also, I know the Star Spangled Banner was made the national anthem, but not right after the war. See, that's where I'm...
You're going to have to choose. You've already chosen once. Would you like to re-choose?
Yes. I think... I think the lie is Columbus on Santa Maria.
Because you couldn't live with yourself if it really was that one and you changed off of it. So you took the safe way out. I'm writing down the point. I will soon tell you which column I put it in. You asked a cogent question about the timing of the Star Spangled Banner, which was actually written as a poem. It was put to music much later. And believe it or not, it was not until 1931 when Herbert Hoover signed it into law that it actually became the national anthem.
I knew that.
Before that, Hail Columbia and My Country Tis of Thee were basically the stand-ins for the national anthem.
Isn't My Country Tis of Thee, isn't that the exact same music as England's national anthem?
Yeah.
Hail to the Queen?
It is indeed the same music, different words.
So I get 2 points for that because I had them both right?
You get 0 points because you chose the wrong one.
No, I said it wasn't right after the War of 1812.
You're right. Game works, Kurt.
John.
If you get it right, you get a point. If you get it wrong, I get a point.
I'm going to ask you if you can find the lie in these three statements about Russia.
Okay. My confidence has just dropped into my ankles.
None of them has to do with Catherine the Great and her equine passion.
Great. My confidence has gone up to my calves.
Number one, Russia has a larger surface area than Pluto. Number two.
An interesting statement. Okay.
Number two, until 2011, beer was considered a soft drink. Number three, there is no legal drinking age in Russia.
Those are hard ones.
One of them's a lie, John.
I'm going to rule out number one as the lie because that just sounds like something that would be true. And it's too creative a lie for you to come up with.
Wow.
Then again, my guess is you had help here anyway. So I have to put that one back on the table. I am going to say the lie is the lack of a drinking age. I believe there's a drinking age in Russia. Dramatic pause, Kurt.
Because I want to see if I remembered what was the right answer.
I should do what you did. Choose two of them as the lie.
I believe the answer is the lie is that there's no legal drinking age. I think you are correct.
How do you want to resolve this, Kurt?
One of our listeners will fact check it and get back to us. Okay. So that's 3 points for you and only one for me.
Except it's four, but I see your point. The sixth question, which I'm going to direct to you, is dedicated to the year that you and I were born.
1973?
Yes, 1973, when we were born, shockingly, at the age of 8.
Yeah, it's crazy how that happened.
We made headlines everywhere.
A hell of a gestation period.
Hell of a, the delivery must have been crazy. That's why they've started putting drains in the floor of OB wards.
Would you ask me a question, please?
1965.
Yes.
The year that we were born. Three statements, two truths and a lie. In 1965, Kurt, The Sound of Music edged out Dr. Zhivago as the top grossing movie.
Truth.
Number two, in 1965, a postage stamp cost 5 cents.
Truth.
In 1965, you see the theme? 1965?
Yeah, I get it now.
When you and I were born, the boy's name Kurt was more popular than the name Jonathan, which, by the way, is my name. By the way, Kurt was your name.
Interesting that you came up with that. So clearly this is crafted. So look, first of all, Sound of Music did beat out Dr. Zhivago. So I know that for truth. Number two, a postage stamp was 5 cents back then. It could have been six. You could have just changed it by 1 cent.
I could have treated it like you treated the JFK question, yes.
But I cannot. Look, Jonathan, you think would be, J-O-H-N would kick Kurt's ass, but this is
J-O-H-N
Jonathan.
J-O-H-N was the number two most popular name in 1965, but I am not using that because my given name is Jonathan.
I have not met many Kurtz, so I'm going to say that's the lie.
You are correct. That is the lie. I thought you would get that instantly because why would I put that in there if that were actually true?
I don't know.
It might be a way to tweak you.
I feel like watching The Princess Bride that you think that I think that you think that I think. And I was doing this mental calisthenics that was making me a little cuckoo.
And I would not have done a postage stamp at 5 cents when it was really six. I wouldn't have taken the JFK approach to question formation. You are correct. Before you go on, though, I want to tell you more about our names. Kurt was actually the 112th most popular boy's name in 1965.
With a K or a C?
With a K, because I know how to spell your name, kind of.
Okay, just making sure.
Jonathan was the 74th most popular name. Now, I said that John was number two. You want to guess what number one was?
Michael.
Correct, but no points.
It was always Michael back then for many years. But now there's no Michaels, there's no Steves, there's no Peters and Kevins. They were a lot when we were growing up.
I'm with you on that.
I think Bathsheba should make a comeback. I think that's a great name.
I could see why. So let's move on with our game. I believe that you need to ask me two truths and a lie.
Shakespeare had a mother and a father.
True.
We're going to talk about his father. His father was a glove maker. His father was a mayor. His father was a musician.
Okay. So this is kind of ridiculous because is his father genuinely well known to the point that people know how he spent his life? So what makes him so well known?
Father of Shakespeare.
Okay, I get it. And we don't hear much about his cousin, though. So do you know that when identical twins have children, their DNA is that of a sibling as opposed to a cousin?
What?
The children of identical twins are genetically siblings, not cousins, because identical twins have the same DNA.
Right. That's cool.
That's where the word identical, remember from My Cousin Vinny, when they were talking about this car versus that car, and he goes, identical.
Love that movie. Oh, my God.
Such a great movie. Okay.
So where are you going?
I'm just going to guess, because I have no idea whether any of those statements are true. If I could eliminate one, then that would give me a 50-50 shot, and I like them odds. However, as a precondition for eliminating one, I'm going to need to remember what the three choices were, Kurt.
His father was a glove maker.
Uh-huh.
His father was a mayor. His father was a musician.
The lie is the glove maker.
That's the one truth that everyone knows about him. Everyone knows his father's a glove maker. He was not a musician.
I was going to guess that. But I was going to guess them all at one point or another. Everyone knows that he was a glove maker?
His father is an odd duck and actually was a mayor and then got in trouble because he stole or he tried to corner the market on wool. And then he would charge a usury tax and he got in trouble and fined for that. So he was mayor. Then he got stripped of that, but he was always a glove maker.
I did not know that, obviously.
I'm reading a book now called Hamnet, which is a fictionalized account of Shakespeare's son, Hamnet, who died of the plague.
Well, I thought that was fun because his father like knitted the gloves in Hamlet and Hamnet. So the fact that the child died, it makes it not fun at all. So Kurt, you come roaring back here in this game. It is now 4-3. You close the margin from 4-1 to 4-3. Can you feel the momentum?
Uncle Mo.
Kurt, I'm going to give you three statements, two truths and a lie. The subject is eBay.
Oh, shoot. Okay.
Statement number one. Someone once tried to sell New Zealand on eBay.
True.
Statement number two. A mask worn by President Trump to protect him from COVID sold for $87,500. Number three. A cornflake in the shape of Illinois sold on eBay for more than $1,000. Two truths and a lie. New Zealand, President Trump, a cornflake.
Had you not put the $500 in, I would have thought that was true, but that was a little trying too hard. So the lie is that Trump's COVID mask protection sold for $87,500.
You would have thought if it were $87,000, you would have thought it would be truthy?
Yes.
You don't think two people were like bidding and bidding, bidding, and one finally said, screw this, $87,500. You are correct. I think it's probably illegal to sell medical stuff as well. You've tied the game at four. It is true that someone once tried to sell New Zealand. The bidding got up. It was a guy in Brisbane, Australia, who was pissed at them over losing the America's Cup sailing championship to New Zealand. And the bidding got to $3,000 before eBay put a stop to the whole thing. And believe it or not, a cornflake in the shape of Illinois sold for $1,350.
The shape of Illinois, I don't even know what shape that is.
I can see it, but it's not exactly like the world.
It's not
the world.
Florida or Texas or something that's got a cool shape, or California.
You know, it's also true that Justin Timberlake's half-eaten French toast was sold on eBay. And it's also true that a grilled cheese sandwich with the face of the Virgin Mary also sold on eBay.
So I knew that sold. That's why.
Who doesn't?
That's why I guessed that if that sold, I knew the cornflake would. All right, John.
It's 4-4.
I'm playing right into your strength.
How many rounds are we playing?
Two more.
Oh, you ask me one, I ask you one, and then we send her off?
Yeah.
All right, lay it on me.
Food.
Ooh, I like food.
Number one, devouring pizza late at night is worse than eating one during the day. Number two, eating eggs won't raise your cholesterol. Number three, beer is just as heart healthy as wine.
Eating pizza late at night is as bad as eating it during the day?
Worse than eating it during the day.
Okay, so I think that's probably true because our metabolism slows at the end of the day and our body doesn't do as much metabolizing as we start to go into the sleep time. Number two was what?
Eating eggs won't raise your cholesterol.
It's not bad for you. But I think you might be pulling one of these good cholesterol, bad cholesterol games here. And the third thing?
Beer is just as heart healthy as wine.
I'm going to go with three as the lie, Kurt.
You think that beer is not as heart healthy as wine?
Whatever you said, I'm saying it's the lie.
Okay, I said beer is just as heart healthy as wine.
I'm saying that's a lie.
You'd be wrong, John.
Is it going to be the cholesterol because it affects the good one or the bad one?
Nope.
Really? Pizza? Why isn't that?
Because your body can digest it the same.
Okay. I don't think that makes sense, but I'm sure you have it on very good source.
And
you eat a lot before you go to bed. It's bad for the whole thing.
Beer is just as heart healthy as wine as long as it's in moderation. It's the same. 2 12-ounces of beer will do the same as 2 6-ounces of wine.
Listen, you win the point. You have taken the lead 5-4. We get to the end here. My last question, you get it right, you win. You get it wrong, we tie.
Okay.
1/4 of all the bones in the human body are in the foot or in our feet.
Mm-hmm.
You're more likely to get a computer virus from a religious website than a porn site. Number three, the inventor of the Pringles can is buried in one.
Something was just talked about, this Pringles one, and I, because I'm a headline guy and not reading the full story, I didn't read it, so I don't know. So let's take these academically. There's no theme here, by the way. You just threw three random shit together, but that's okay.
Well, hang on. I've had themes each time. This is my theme here is miscellany.
Yeah, okay. Potpourri for 500, please, Gene.
Exactly. That's a legitimate, established Jeopardy.
Okay, Richard Dawson, potpourri on Match Game 75. Oh, no, okay,
that was Gene Rayburn. Richard Dawson was Family Feud. Get your game show host right, Kurt.
Okay, Richard Dawson did a bunch of them too. But anyway, all right. So, shitload of bones in a foot. That's true. Pringles guy being buried in it. That sounds true to me. What's the middle one?
You're more likely to get a computer virus on a religious site than a porn site.
I think that's true too. I'll say the Pringles guy did not get buried in his can. That's a lie.
Sadly, or not sadly, depending on your perspective, the Pringles guy is buried in one. And when his kids picked it up, the can, they had to decide which flavor to go with.
Oh.
And they decided to choose original. The gentleman's name was Frederick Bauer. he is buried in a can of Pringles original flavor. And by the way, I also learned that the shape of a Pringles is called a hyperbolic paraboloid. Good for him.
It's definitely parabolic in shape, that's for sure.
Yeah, so the lie was, oh shit, those are all true.
All right, give me another one for the game.
Kurt, so one more to go. I'm going to ask you a pretty simple one, very simple statements. Here are the three statements. A rainbow that happens at night is called a moonbow. The stage before frostbite is called frostnip. A reflection in the water is called a splash beam. I'll read them to you again.
No, you don't need to. I got it. I think it is impossible to have a rainbow in the dark, because I believe a rainbow by its nature is a light coming through a prism. So I think the lie is that a rainbow is called a moonbeam or moonbow.
So it's not called that. You're saying it's a lie that it's called a moonbow.
Yes.
Well, we're going to have to start finding a sister to kiss.
Oh, no.
It is true that a rainbow can happen at night, and it's called a moonbow. It is also true that there is a stage before frostbite called frostnip. But it is not true that a reflection in the water is called a splash beam. That I made up.
Splash beam. Okay, good.
But I learned some other amazing things as we were putting these together. I'm sure you did as well. You and I have mentioned Guinness a few times during our podcast. Guinness calculated that 163,000 pints of Guinness are wasted every year by being caught in men's facial hair when they're drinking.
That's why I shave, John.
Yes. They say it takes about 10 sips to finish a Guinness, and you can lose a lot if you have one of those big, bushy mustaches.
All right. Well, listen, I think this could be a franchise for Smart Dribble. This was a lot of fun, and there's a ton out there. I think you did an excellent job crafting yours, and I look forward to more of these in the future because we both love trivia, and we both love to try to work our way through things.
We have to do this again because we ended in a tie, and that's not where we want to end things. And while we're not really competing, it was fun to go through these, and I agree we could do many more just like it. So thank you, everybody, for joining us for this week's episode of Smart Dribble. If you have two truths and a lie of your own that you'd love to share, you can find us at Smart Dribble on Twitter, Instagram.
Weren't we banned from Twitter, John?
Not yet, but it's inevitable.
Okay.
And we also can be found at smartdribble.com. So we would love to hear from you. Kurt and I will be back next week with a brand new episode of Smart Dribble. Until then, we hope your week is filled with Smart Dribble. Goodbye, everybody.
Peace, guys.